it's complicated getting from, I'm walking through the kitchen or walking down the street to I'm having a climax. And so the stage where you're walking around and not necessarily sexually aware or having those frequent sexual thoughts, we have information processing models for that, where we say you have to not only encounter a stimulus that could be sexual, but you have to understand it that way in your brain. So even if you see a nude body, doesn't mean you get aroused. You have to say, I'm attracted to that. I am able to respond to it. We've often now started talking about the next phase in conjunction with desire. So we used to think desire precedes arousal, then we get arousal. Now we really think desire is the recognition of arousal. So it's like you've started to have some process where your body's activated, mind is activated, and then you say, oh, I'm getting aroused. I think I want to do something sexual. And that stage, we have studied a ton. So there are hundreds of studies where we show people pornography that lasts 3 to 5 minutes. During that period, we see increases in activity of dopamine receptors, especially in D2, D3. So these are motivational areas, typically. So ventral striatal, where they're becoming activated, increasing the likelihood of motor output. We see an increase in attention. So there's a suppression of the alpha response, the 8 to 12 hertz and electroencephalographic signals, which basically just means I'm trying to do something. I'm focusing on a thing. I'm putting effort towards becoming aroused. Because you can also pretty easily distract yourself if you don't want to be aroused. Say you're in public on a bus and it's not a good time to get an erection. Those processes are really pretty effortful and directed. Now with fMRI research, we often talk about networks rather than individual lobes. So there are obviously debates about even the number of networks. Most people would say it's the cingulate opercular, or the salience network in the brain that becomes active during that period.
What do we know about how these changes in the brain vary across the gender? So a man versus a woman?
From my read of it, the few studies that have suggested there are gender differences so far, we've found they don't hold up and they're really attributable to desire differences. On average, if you look cross-culturally, men tend to report higher sex drive than women. Obviously, this is on average. For example, there was a study some years ago that said men have more amygdala activity, so maybe it's because they're more engaged with the pornography we're showing them. There have been a couple other studies like that. You think you found a gender distinction, but it's really just to do with you're not stimulus matching. So you have to have something that's as appealing to women as to men. And for example, the same types of sexual images we show to men, if you show those to women, they're much more likely to find them disgusting or a turnoff for a variety of reasons that we've looked at. The only place they really differ is just in motor strip activity, which is blatant. That is, the penis and vagina are represented in slightly different places on the motor cortex.
Have there been studies that have compared the changes in our neural networks or imaging or EEG changes between masturbation, which is self-stimulation, versus the act of sex between two people?
We don't really have a sex act study, like something that's actual penetration. Ours is probably the closest insofar as like we have people interacting. Whenever you have a couple in for a study, you have to think about continual consent issues. What are you going to do if one person wants to leave and the other still wants to stay? How are they going to let you know? All of those things. So there are lots of serious issues of managing the ethics around those types of studies that make them difficult to do anyway. And in the U.S., the worst. We're so restrictive. Our IRBs tend to regard these studies as high risk, like something's going to happen to them. And we're like, they're masturbating all the time. They do this to themselves a lot. For example, with the orgasmic meditation too, that was stimulating the clitoris. And people often ask, why didn't you do the guys? I don't know that we could get that through ethics. To turn it around, say we're going to have women stimulating a male penis while they're doing this study. We could try, maybe based on the previous study and everything went well. You know, we had no ethics issues come up during that time. And obviously we were very careful and respectful of those things. But I don't know that we could, because it's viewed as prostitution. It's like we're paying people to come in and the woman's going to stimulate the man. Well, of course she is. That's this whole other act that they don't view as happening that way when it's the other way around.
I would love for you to clarify what the current neuroscience research suggests about the impact of pornography, or I should say regular consumption of pornography or exposure to pornography on the brain's reward systems?
We actually know quite a lot about the brain response to sexual images. In general, sexual images are viewed by affective neuroscientists as being pleasant, intense stimuli, and they're commonly used to study emotional processes. Put that another way, sexual images are so regularly experienced as positive that scientists rely on them to produce that response. That is a healthy, normal response to view pornography with pleasure. There have been some studies to try and say, like, is there anything unique, right? Is there a sex area of the brain or something that separates it out? There really doesn't seem to be. There's nothing unique to sexual arousal per se. I always see these plots where they say, oh, pornography is as intense as cocaine or is as damaging as cocaine. Nowhere near, not even close. That does not come from a scientific paper. Some of the things it cannot do that are different from self-touch or partnered sex is in partners, we get activation of C afferent fibers and hairy skin. It seems to be highly unique. They only become activated when stroked at a certain frequency, not fast, not slow, but like a moderate frequency with another ungloved human hand. So that effect seems to be really specific to partnered touch. Another thing porn doesn't do is one of the main predictors of satisfaction in a sexual interaction is feeling desired. Okay, if nobody else is there, you can't feel desired by definition, I would say. We know a lot of the claims where if you view a lot of pornography, it makes you less sensitive or insensitive to a real partner. We found exactly the opposite. That is, people who viewed more pornography in their daily life actually reported more sexual arousal anticipating and then following the sexual act. And what I think that's sensitive to is people who watch more pornography tend to have a higher sex drive. They're not only watching more pornography, they're more likely to engage in spanking, engage in other BDSM behaviors, seek out swinging, they're using toys, they're doing a lot more things, including viewing porn.
What are some of the harmful myths and misunderstanding around the subject of sex that is potentially causing a lot of harm in our communities and the society at large?
There are a lot of abstinence programs now, so semen retention is becoming popular again, unfortunately, and they make a lot of claims that are not true, some of which are if you retain that you're going to increase your testosterone. In fact, if you're more sexually active, your testosterone titers actually increase. It's in a very particular way. So throughout the day, testosterone oscillates, and it's really the nadir they're talking about. So testosterone doesn't go as low during the vacillations if you're more sexually active. So the abstinence does not help your testosterone. They sometimes say sperm factors are better. They're talking about those studies looking at fertility and if we're going to take a donation to help our partner become pregnant, what's the best way to do that? Very reasonable question. There seems to be some benefit to having had an abstinence of at least 6 hours, and the benefit seems to fall off. So the semen retention claims that ejaculating too much is going to hurt your sperm, they're just not true.